are locked in a virtual war. In the process, television crew have been attacked by the police for simply doing their job. So in part one, we ask, has the Haryana government bungled badly? Or does Rampal's intransigence and defiance provide some explanation for this appalling mishap? And now joining me to discuss the hangama in Haryana is BJP National Executive Member Satpal Jain, Congress spokesperson and MP Rajiv Gowda, the former Chief Secretary of Delhi Shailaja Chandra, and the well-known academic and author Purushottam Agarwal. Satpal Jain, today the Haryana police stormed self-styled Godman Rampal's ashram, and we saw and heard on television that women and children had been badly beaten and many members of the press physically, if not at times, brutally attacked. Was this inevitable, or will you concede that the Haryana government has bungled this operation?
See, Mr. Karan, if you appreciate the facts and the circumstances leading to today's situation, you will very easily find an answer there. For the last few days, the Haryana government was facing a very complex situation. There was an order of the High Court to arrest one Mr. Sant Rampal, who, according to the High Court, is a contemner and an accused. This fellow was using and is still using thousands and thousands of men, women and children as his shield, who consider him to be a god or a saint, like a god they were treating him. So the Haryana police had to execute the orders of the High Court, but without causing any hurt or the minimum hurt or any collateral loss to the innocent women,
that's the
children,
problem, Mr.
and thousands
Jain.
Of people who were sitting around him.
Mr. Jain, that's the problem. They executed the instructions of the court, not with minimal collateral damage, but fairly close to sizable and substantial and worrying damage. Now, I'm asking you a simple question. Could this storming not have been done in a better way, in a more professional way, with less damage, or was it inevitable this would happen?
Yes, I reply to that. Had the same action been done 1 or 2 days earlier, 3 days earlier, as some media persons are suggesting, the loss would have been the worst. The collateral loss damage would have been the worst. Today also, the police tried to use as much restraint as they could. And the only strategy was that create a situation where the human force that Sant Rampal was using is reduced to the minimum. Unfortunate incident happens where the media persons were attacked and nobody can defend that action. Any policeman doing that action should be condemned, and we condemn that. But since the Sant Rampal's followers used petrol bombs, they were having the gas cylinders as a shield within the ashram. They fired at the police. Therefore, this was a situation which ultimately had to be met with the same force, and police did the same thing.
All right. Let me bring in some of the others who are independent and see to what extent they agree with you. The argument you're getting, Mr. Agarwal, is that if this operation had been conducted 2 or 3 days earlier, the collateral damage would have been much worse. Therefore, the suggestion is somehow the police have chosen the most appropriate timing. Do you accept that?
Well, I find it difficult to accept. And secondly, so far as so many people being inside the ashram is concerned, I'm really surprised that why police allowed so many people to enter the ashram. Because this thing has been going on for quite some time, I think at least for a week. So was police not aware that these people are entering the ashram and they might be used as human shield at a later stage?
So you're saying two things. Not only is the claim that the timing was appropriate a mistaken claim, but in addition, there was laxity on the part of the police.
There was laxity.
Because they allowed a situation to build up, creating a crisis.
There was utter lack of professionalism on part of police, and Mr. Jain used a very interesting expression, which I think gives the key. That with minimum political loss. So police and their bosses were actually more concerned with the political loss than with actually upholding the rule of law professional manner.
That's a very good point, and I'll go back to Mr. Jain on it in a moment's time. But first I want to bring you in, Mr. Chandra, and put this to you. Would you accept that there's a sort of catch-22 situation the government in Haryana was caught in? If it hadn't acted, its authority was being undermined progressively and would have continued to be undermined. But if it did act, There was always a danger that there would be violence, as clearly turned out to be the case. So as a former senior civil servant, if you had been there advising the government, what in this circumstance would you have told them to do?
Well, if there is an order from the High Court, you have to follow the rule of law. There is no way, after they had tried to convince the High Court that, well, this could be parried, they were not able to. Well, they had to carry out the order. And I think that we are living slowly and steadily, we are going into a state of anarchy. Think of all that has gone wrong with this. How has this godman acquired this huge...
I'll come to that moment, Sam, but you're saying a very important thing. You're saying once they had an order from the High Court, regardless of what the physical cost or the cost in terms of collateral damage, it has to be executed.
Yes, because there is a way in which the police have to act, the way the magistracy have to act. They would have to use water cannons. After that, they'd have to resort to firing. Did you want a situation where all these women and children are fired at? At least dragging them out was one way. One has to look at the circumstances. Not everything can be put in cotton wool and all the time a media sitting and in judgment on this. I think this is a very, very, very dangerous phenomena which is taking place.
Rajiv Gowda, the situation today is a problem for the successor government to yours in Haryana, Mr. Satpal Jain. But till 3 weeks ago, Bhupinder Singh Hooda and the Congress Party were ruling Haryana, and you ruled that state for 10 consecutive years. Now, clearly, the planning and preparation that has been visible today from the side of Sant Rampal, if I may call him Sant Rampal, and his so-called supporters, suggests that it's been underway for a long while. These weapons, these so-called crude petrol bombs, these acid pouches, this collection of some 15, 20, some say even 50,000 people hasn't happened overnight. Would you accept that there was considerable laxity shown by your government in allowing the situation to get to this point?
Karan, basically it's our government that has filed the cases, that has pursued the cases in the court, and which is why this Sant Rampal is facing the kind of legal action that he is facing. So, you know, in the last few months, there has been a change of government, and if there has been a build-up, it has probably happened afterwards.
Last 3 weeks. And I'm not talking about the legal action you brought against Mr. Rampal.
Yeah.
I'm talking about the fact that you permitted the build-up of weaponry, the collection of perhaps, according to some press sources, as many as 50, 60,000 of his supporters, thus allowing his ashram to be converted into a fortress. Are you guilty of laxity in permitting that to happen?
No. I do not think that 50, 60,000 people have been staying there for the last many weeks before the change of government. It looks to me, I do not know the exact facts on that, but I think that is a very recent phenomenon once the court order came and there was a move. So if any laxity is there, it is on the part of the current BJP government, which is not only lax in terms of allowing this situation to get out of control, but also terrible in terms of sending the signal that the media can be assaulted and essentially that coverage should not be allowed, etc. This is just these are all newer developments that have taken place since after our government has handed over the baton.
Mr. Jain, let me put this to you. The supporters of this Mr. Rampal were armed. They not only had guns, they had acid pouches and crude petrol bombs. Now, when the police decided that they had to storm this ashram, were they adequately prepared for the situation that they were confronting, or did they go in unprepared? Because looking at it on television today, it seems they were woefully unprepared.
See, so far as the police is concerned, police was fully prepared to meet any situation that we had to meet. And if you have heard the press conference of the DGP Haryana, this is one of the reasons that he gave as to why the situation came. He says, the moment we started moving, then some media persons who were also moving along with us, we told them not to go because there was a firing from
just
the other
just
side.
Just note, I'm not talking, Mr. Jain, I'm interrupting you. I'm not talking about the media incidents.
Just a minute.
I'm not talking about the media incidents. I'll come to that separately. I'm asking you a different question.
I'm asking you whether you were prepared for the situation inside the ashram,
the bombs, the acid pouches, the weaponry.
Yes. I am replying to that. Police was fully prepared, but when the media persons came in, one of the explanations, somebody may agree, somebody may not agree, given by the DGP is that when they were starting to retaliate and fire back or do whatever they wanted to do, then they thought that some media persons were also standing, and since they never wanted any loss to be caused to the media, police was ready to face any situation, media was not. In that scuffle, this unfortunate thing happened. So far as the other party is concerned, I must remind my friend Mr. Gowda, 2 days back, Mr. Randeep Surjewala came on the television channels, and you know what he said? He said, Congress wants Sant to be arrested, but without causing any loss, either to any child or to any woman. So far as the High Court order is concerned, they want the order to be executed, but khush rahe Bhagwan, Raji rahe Sayad bhi, that don't cause any loss to any person, but at the time, arrest Sant also. And I want to remind him, this issue started in 2006.
Absolutely.
We took over on 26th of October.
Let's not go back into.
We'll go back
into history in due course. I want you to explain something else while you're still talking to me. What did you mean by that phrase that the police were told to do this with minimum political loss? Professor Agarwal picked it up and accurately pointed it out. What did you mean by minimum political loss? Are you concerned about the political rather than the humanitarian aspect of this?
No. Oh, no. I said minimum collateral loss, not political. Collateral loss without causing any loss, either to any child or to lady. No question of any political gain or loss. I'm sorry, either I pronounced it wrongly or he understood it wrongly. No question of any political loss or gain. It was a collateral loss.
The
High Court has also used that word.
I'll accept your explanation. Let's now come to what happened to the media. Let me put it first to you, Mr. Agarwal. Not just one or two reporters, but the entire spectrum of television reporters and television photojournalists were attacked. Several of them physically, several of them very, very nastily. Can that be explained by the frenzy of the moment, as the DGP was trying to suggest at his press conference?
Again,
or is it a worse collapse of police behavior, police procedure?
Again, Karan, the problem is, you see, this comes out in the statements of politicians and civil servants unwittingly. They have to do something, they have to execute the court order, and at the same time, they do not want to be seen as using maximum force or causing damage to people. So media is there, and if media is there, then they are going to show the images of police action, they are going to show the images of policemen wielding lathis or whatever. So maybe, I do not know, maybe it was at the local level the officers present there, or maybe they were under instructions from the top that when you go into real action, please remove the media from there. So maybe this was decided by the local officers, or maybe it was instructions from the top that when you go in for real action, when you actually use force, remove the media from there.
Maybe that is
probably the explanation.
Let me, Mr. Chandra, put a sort of devil's advocate question to you. The explanation you're getting from Mr. Jain, and he's quoting the DGP, is that in fact, that because the media was there and was in danger of getting hit by the shooting from inside the ashram, they had to be physically removed. Sometimes that could be the case. Media journalists often, out of heroism, endanger themselves. But do they have to be removed in this barbaric, physically cruel way, which we saw on television? Are there not other more professional ways? And secondly, and this is attached to the first question, if the police knew, as they must have, that they were going to storm, they shouldn't have got the media out to begin with before they did it.
I don't think the police invited the media. I think the media is vying with each other. Every channel is vying with each other to get the maximum coverage. This is their job. I do feel that it is a warlike situation. It is a situation where you cannot have media going, because media will want to position itself in a way that it gets the best shots. If there's hurt, if there's firing, if anything goes wrong over there, who is going to take responsibility? In an operational situation, you cannot have, even in warlike, even when you have embedded journalists, you know about embedded journalists more than I do, this amounts to that. You bring them in, but then after that, who is going to take responsibility?
So that in this situation, when the police asked the media to leave and the media were reluctant to do so, were the police right to physically...
They were completely right. We are living in a civilized country. The police are the last word on the, in a situation where there is law and order at stake, where firing is going to take place. You cannot have TRPs and the channels, you might say, competition superseding what is going to happen to all those people just to get a little bit of limelight. It's not on.
Mr. Gowda, a moment ago when you were speaking, you were sharply critical of the Haryana police and the Haryana government's handling of the media. If I'm right in my memory, you described it as brutal conduct. Now you have Mrs. Chandra, a former chief secretary, Delhi, saying that in fact, if the media is endangering themselves in the course of their duty, bravery as that may be on their part, it is the police duty to remove them. And if the media won't go, then they must be physically removed. And sometimes that will entail the sort of scenes we saw. Do you accept her argument or do you think her argument is mistaken?
Her argument is fine in theory. In practice, what has happened here is that the media got police permission to go along. And then the police should have worked out an arrangement with them saying, if this development takes place or things turn worse, then that's where you stop. We cannot let you get endangered. But that's not what happened. You said, come along. And then you basically broke, you know, sort of lati charged them and brutally assaulted them and, you know, destroyed their equipment. Now, in all those 10 years of Congress rule in Haryana, we didn't see any such assaults in the media. So there's a lot of people are asking questions whether this is really a way of the new government sending a signal to the media that we're going to, you know, put you in your place and we're going to ensure that you're going to behave yourself. You know, there are all sorts of questions people are asking, and it's what we saw on TV with those media people, personnel being hounded and attacked was really the worst kind of environment and development that we've seen in a long time.
Okay.
It is really worrisome in from the context of media freedom, and you know, I agree with Mrs. Chandra that, you know, these are situations that could turn uglier, but those are the rules of engagement that you need to
okay.
work out ahead of time and not not at the you know, at the, put the media at
okay.
the receiving end of lathis and worse.
Before I go back to Mr. Jain, I want to put to you a question in a sense that I put to Mrs. Chandra. The police invited the media to be present to witness it because they wanted to ensure that there was no allegations made afterwards that the police had mishandled the situation. The media, in a sense, would therefore be witness to the police and the way they function. Was that, at the end of the day, a wise decision? Because when you know you're physically storming a place where you're going to be resisted, and presumably you're aware that the people there are armed, even if you don't know they have bombs and acid pouches, and you know that there's going to be collateral damage and violence, should the media be there at all? Should you not have cleared the area first and said, sorry, there's an operation happening, almost a military operation, you have to be at least a kilometer or more away.
Well,
clear it,
well,
and don't look for witnesses to prove later on that you acted properly. You can't, on the one hand, use the media as a witness to prove your credentials and then turn on the media as well.
Number one, as you put it. Secondly, I think it's a very, very serious, and to put it rather bluntly, a dangerous argument to say that police has the last word on these matters. Police cannot have the last word on these matters. Otherwise, I do not know about anarchy, but we must be certainly heading towards a police state. That is number one. Number two, as you said, and there were reports in the afternoon, that in fact media was taken by the police there in order to be witness to a properly conducted operation and all that. I think the administration failed in its imagination. This brings to my mind, if you recall, Operation Black Thunder in 1989 or that. And it was much more serious in its dimensions of all kind, logistic as well as political and as well as the international ramifications. Media was put there, media was told its limits, and then the operation was conducted. Probably the government at that time had learnt its lessons from 1984. Here you are going to storm a place where there are 50,000 people with crude bombs and kind of weaponry, and then you first take media there, then you want to push the media away using all kind of brutal force. I do not think that it is justified in any way.
Let's put that to Mr. Jain. Mr. Jain, the argument has widened beyond what I was accusing you of a moment ago. I said that you bungled it because you weren't prepared for the nature of the response you were going to get. Now we're also being told by Professor Agarwal that the planning to ensure that the media was there as a sort of witness to the way the police conducted themselves, that itself was badly done. It needed to be more carefully thought out. You needed to have borne in mind the possible consequences that could follow and had guarded against them. None of that happened. And what he's saying is that there was a failure of what he calls the imagination. And I think he means the critical analysis of your political government in Chandigarh.
May I reply to your question a little later and first clarify that the police did not invite media to come with them. The police only permitted them to cover the incident, and as per the DGP's version, the police instead of the media instead of covering the incident from a particular distance started moving along with the forces. But anyhow, what I am saying is this, that after every incident there are two views which are possible. Now the question is the view that was taken by those people who were handling that situation, whether it was possible or not. Secondly, whether their intentions were bona fide or it was taken with any malice towards any media or towards any person. Those who were handling the situation, they thought that in case we do not stop the media here, then the firing which has started coming from the ashram, the petrol bombs that have started coming from the ashram and the stones that have come, if they are ultimately thrown towards the media, this would not be in good taste. It is not desirable. So they thought of asking the media to kindly revert back and to move back. I say,
I love your euphemism. They thought of asking the media to kindly revert
very politely,
back. I applaud you for your diplomatic choice of euphemistic language.
Very politely,
I think that awards an award for sure, Mr. Jain. Let me put this to you, Mr. Chandra.
No, the DGP said something that very first we appealed to them, and when they did not come back, when they did not move back, then they were asked to move.
And then when they didn't move back, finally they were pushed and lathi charged and made to move. That just finishes the sequence. Mr. Chandra, let me put this to you. A year ago, I think, there was an equally touchy, awkward, precarious situation in the case of Asaram Bapu, a much bigger person than this alleged Sant Rampal. The media was equally concerned, and the number of devotees involved would have been perhaps considerably greater. It didn't lead to any of the sort of violence, either against the media or against Asaram Bapu's own supporters, as we've seen now. Does that suggest that at that time the Congress government or whatever government was involved handled it a lot better than now?
I wouldn't say that a particular government has to be credited or discredited.
The police in that case?
The police could, but please remember, I don't think in Asaram's case petrol bombs were being thrown. I don't think that stoning was going on in the way it's going on here. This would have definitely led to firing. I don't think in Asaram's case firing was even anticipated. The two situations are not on par. The only situation is, how are we getting godmen to be allowed to take vast tracts of land and build fortresses? What is the bureaucracy
and
doing?
And then
what
get away the with defying
doing?
The court.
And get away with defying the
court.
In
fact, when we come to that question of how do godmen end up getting away with defying the court, I want to bring you in at that point, Mr. Gada. It's quite clear that this gentleman, Mr. Rampal, wanted the same treatment as the Dera Sacha Sauda Chief Gurmeet Ram Rahim Singh. In his case, the Haryana Police, when it was under Congress control, allowed him, in fact encouraged him, to give his statements to court via video conferencing, right, rather than appear personally. And Mr. Rampal was simply insisting that he should be treated the same way. And I put it to you that the first precedent of allowing alleged godmen to defy the court and find short-circuited, easy ways of presenting themselves was your handling of Gurmeet Ram Rahim Singh. Rampal simply wanted to follow the precedent you had very badly set in the earlier
case.
I wouldn't agree with you at all.
I'm not
think
surprised.
In that particular case, there are other conflicts associated with Dera Sacha Sauda. There have been clashes between Ram Rahim Singh supporters and other groups, and so there may have been a threat perception that got the government to say, look, if he comes out and goes to the court, there may be other clashes. There may have been a much more complicated situation that led to that decision, and there is no reason for that decision to serve as a precedent for Ram Lal in this case. So I wouldn't compare the two either.
I just want to make one point. I think let us put this entire debate in perspective. It's not a question of Congress versus BJP. Basically, it has become a question of Indian state surrendering ground to all kind of fringe elements in the name of religious sentiment or caste sentiment or whatever. For example, Let me remind you one incident. A yoga guru announces a decision to launch a political campaign, arrives in Delhi, and is received at the airport with five senior ministers in the row, as if he's a head of state.
Absolutely.
What kind of precedent the Congress government set?
In fact, that's a very interesting incident you mentioned. It was in the case of Baba Ramdev.
And
subsequently, the minister who led that delegation, Pranab Mukherjee, has said in a book that Rajiv Sardesai has published, it was a bad and big blunder.
Bad and big blunder and a bad precedent.
Absolutely.
Which anybody can follow and you will not have anything to say on that.
You know, the one thing that amazes me about the situation is, has the Haryana police been sending out mixed signals to this Mr. Rampal and his supporters? Because the amicus curiae in this case, Anupam Gupta, said on Sunday that on that day there was a massive standoff between Rampal supporters and the state police assisted by central forces. But suddenly at 7:30, the state police and the central forces withdrew. And Mr. Gupta's conclusion is that in fact mixed signals were going. There was no one single consistent policy. Every 3 or 4 hours the police were changing around their policy. Were they therefore sending the wrong signals to Mr. Rampal?
I'm sure they were, and I think increasingly this is taking place. No aspersions on political parties, but they are both squarely to blame for jumping into areas which are no concern of theirs. Law and order in a district is totally the district magistrate and the police's responsibility. Why is it escalating higher and higher? Why are politicians taking meetings? Why are politicians deciding even what route to take, this way or that way?
And what they're doing is undermining the authority of the officer or official who should be in charge.
There is a statutory. You see, every officer wears two hats, and one is the loyalty to the state. When the state comes in, they do not have to take orders from politicians, but they do, because politicians have made them grovel and they are happy to grovel. That's a different story. But I would say that in this case, the district magistrate and the police could have handled it long ago had the politicians not given shelter to people like this.
You know, I'm going to bring you in, Mr. Jain, and ask you not only to answer that particular point from Mrs. Chandra, that the manner in which political leaders interfere with the authority and autonomy of district level officials and district level police officials undermines their ability to act. But I want to ask you a second question as well. How is it that we discover this level of arms inside the ashram, crude petrol bombs and acid pouches, and the police don't seem to have been aware this could have happened? Was there, in addition to bad preparation and planning, also an intelligence failure?
So far as the first question is concerned, I agree with her that unfortunately, you may belong to any party, any government, there has been a trend on the part of the politicians to unnecessarily, unduly interfere in the working of the honest officer. I am using the word honest purposely, because there are certain situations where the situations are complicated only by the officers, by the police and magistrates and other officers, because of lack of experience on their part. So therefore, whereas there should be clear-cut direction in the right way on the part of the party in power, but at the same time, the execution should be left to the officers, maybe district magistrate, SDM, police officers. So far as your second part is concerned, I like to tell you that the whole situation was given to the High Court judges in a sealed cover. The High Court judges went through the entire report, and I will just read one sentence from the order of the High Court, where the High Court says, on a perusal of the note circulated confidentially in a sealed cover, we hope and trust that the non-bailable warrant issued by this court would be executed in a short while without much bloodshed. It was to our knowledge to the police
from the beginning. Can I interrupt?
But that was the precisely reason waiting for a right moment to take that action.
Can I interrupt you? Are you suggesting that the High Court had been made aware by the police in a sealed cover that in fact there was a certain level of equipment, bombs, etc., armed supporters inside the ashram, and any deliberate storming would incur their wrath and violence, and the High Court overlooked that? Is that what you're suggesting?
No. I'm not suggesting that. I have not
what
seen
are
that
you suggesting?
Confidential report. It was between the police officer and the High Court. But I'm very sure but I'm very sure that the sealed cover report must have contained all those facts, and that is the reason.
So then you are suggesting
the High Court records are finding.
Make up your mind, Mr. Jet. If you're very sure those facts were in the sealed covered report, then you are suggesting
I'm suggesting that is my